I'm with Graham Hughes. Woo!
Nepal, Tibet, China, Mongolia.
Welcome to Korea.
North Korea,
Japan,
Taiwan,
Vietnam,
Cambodia,
He's been described as the thinking woman's Indiana Jones.
Now, many people dream of travelling around the world, but could you imagine doing it without stepping foot on a plane? And there's one man who's done just that.
But tonight we meet an intrepid traveller who is going to every country in the world by public transport. In fact, Graham Hughes from Liverpool. Now, Graham Hughes from Liverpool likes to travel a bit.
At every country in the world in one journey, but there's a twist. He can't fly or use any private transport.
さんの挑戦も始まったばっかりということで、でも4年かかってるんですよね。すごい。で、本日はスカイプでですね、グレアム・ヒューズさんとつながっているということで、グレアムさん、ヒューズさん、
welcome to the show. How are you? And which will see Graham Hughes qualify for entry in the Guiness Book of Records.
Google me.
You're Graham Hughes.
You're goddamn right.
Hello.
This gent here is Mr. Graham Hughes. He has traveled 201 countries in 46 months. He did it without any airplanes. And he has set the Guinness World Record for the first and only person to do this.
Almost. We'll come back to that.
I've been telling all my buddies I want to travel 195 countries before I turn 30 or die trying. And
okay.
I've had about 22 of my friends send me this guy's article saying, have a read. And it was a message from God that I need to get in touch with this guy to tell me how not to die. So I reached out to him saying, how do I not die? Tell me in 30 minutes and all my friends listen in. And so here we are.
Okay. All right, well, what do you want to know? First up, go on Wikipedia and type in list of ongoing armed conflicts, right? There's not that many of them. There's about five in the world. And the countries where there are an ongoing armed conflict, be very careful where you go. That's my top advice, really.
And then you'll probably survive.
Yeah, that's it. I'm going now. Bye.
Okay, Graham, I got to introduce you to my boy. This is Indy Blue.
Hello, Indy Blue.
He's an experienced traveler. He's been to 56 countries or 52. And apparently he met you. He met you somewhere.
Where did you meet me?
In Sri Lanka. You remember in Negumbo?
In Negumbo? Oh my God. I was probably a little bit, drunk. Maybe.
So was I. Yeah. That's good.
Were you staying at Sasha Mir's place?
Sasha Mir's place in Negumbo.
I remember, yeah. Oh my God, it's such a small world.
It's crazy, right? Okay, wow. Graham, let's talk about the small world. Tell us, number one, how much did it cost to travel 201 countries in 46 months?
It cost me about, $10,000 a year. Probably a bit less than that. So in British pounds, it was about £27,000 for the 4 years.
So under $40,000, you traveled every country in the world. That's incredible.
It would have cost me more to have a flat in London, a dog, and a smoking habit. So people say, oh, you must be rich. And I'm like, well, do you smoke? And they're like, yeah. And I'm like, well, you must be richer because I can't afford to smoke.
Okay, next question. That's good to know. Give us the how-to guide to traveling the world without planes. What's your secrets? How do you do that?
You've got to, first of all, smile everywhere you go. Just have a really good, positive attitude because people respond to that. And tell them that you're not just traveling for the hell of it. Tell them that it's your dream. It's you've always wanted to do this. And get people on board with the journey everywhere you go. I couch surfed everywhere, so I didn't stay in hotels or backpackers. I stayed with
local
people.
But how did you meet people like all across the world?
The Couchsurfing Network, couchsurfing.org, it's the best website in the world, it's absolutely fantastic. You just write to people and say, can I keep it yours for the night? And they say, yeah, sure.
So you're just using the websites and stuff?
Yeah, and everywhere's got the internet. That's why it's called the World Wide Web. But,
you're
yeah,
my,
yeah, it, awesome. it's, quite worldwide. It's just a case of getting yourself out there as well. For example, it's not just all done on the internet. When I was in Dubai, first night I was there, I ended up playing pool with these British guys, and one of them was the general manager of logistics for CMA CGM, the big shipping firm that I needed to get me to India, the next place I was going to. And it was just, I just ran into him playing pool. And I said, I need your help to get on the ship. And a few weeks later, he was the guy who drove me to the port to put me on the ship. So it was all about socializing and getting yourself out there and having fun and just seeing what happened. And always having a plan B and a plan C and a plan D and a plan F.
It's the same thing for me. I'm documenting my trip through Central and South America. And I have people reaching out from all over the world trying to help me, places to stay, things to do. It's really incredible.
Well, most people want to help you. I mean, that's just human nature, I guess. So,
Now, speaking of people who want to help you, let's talk about people who want to harm you. How close were you to death? And tell us a horror story. One of the most terrifying things that's happened to you on your travel.
I don't know. I had a tuna sandwich at Mayonnaise in Australia. The mayonnaise over there is really messed up looking. Do you know what I mean? That was probably the scariest thing that I had. I was like, what?
Really?
Am I supposed to eat this? I didn't get robbed. I didn't get mugged. I didn't get injured.
You traveled 201 countries and you never even got stuck up. Not even a moment.
No. Do you know what? I've got to say something, right? Every single story that I've heard involving a backpacker who's run into trouble has begun with the words, I was buying these drugs and you just stay on the side of the angels and you should be fine.
Amen, sir. Amen. Amen. That's exactly common sense.
There's also you need awareness of where you're going. I mean, I did a lot of research before I left on each country that I was going to and knew where the safe places were. So I only went to the north of Afghanistan, the north of Iraq, for instance. I mean, I think it's just people who say, oh, I don't bother with guidebooks, I just turn off and see what happens. I think they're a little bit irresponsible. And also, people who don't take the malaria pills, I think they're absolutely crazy, because I know people, friends of friends, who have died from malaria. And it's that attitude of, oh, you know, it's fine. You just get a runny nose, don't you? And you're like, no, there's different types of malaria, and there's one that kills you in 2 days. And if you've not been taking any pills to stop it happening, cerebral malaria will just eat your brain away, and you will not survive.
Well, you know what, Graham? Honestly, it's a major relief to know it's not as dangerous as everybody says it is. Now, let's flip it a bit. What's the most spectacular things you've ever seen while you're traveling the world? What's some things that just jaw-dropping?
Okay, so I went to Jellyfish Lake in the island of the island nation of Palau in the Pacific Ocean. It's this lake with these jellyfish in, and they've evolved to have no sting because they have no enemies, and so there's millions of them and you can swim with them. I think they're the only animals that actually make their energy through photosynthesis. And I swam in this lake with these jellyfish and there were billions of them, ranging from the full size ones to the little tiny polyps just going around, all these little translucent floating boobs in the water like this. It was just incredible. I had my snorkel on and it was like being on another planet. It was like playing Star Fox, but for real life, in real life. there was some great sort of opportunities with wildlife. Got to see the Komodo dragons in Indonesia. I also got to see, get up close and personal with the orangutans in Borneo and the lemurs in Madagascar. That was fantastic. I think one of the highlights of my journey was seeing one of the space shuttles taking off from Cape Canaveral in Florida. I just happened to be there in one of the last ones. I turned up to Cape Canaveral early that morning and got a ticket for the causeway. And I was first in the queue because I'm a huge geek. And they let me in. And no one's going to see that anymore. It's been retired now, so no one's going to see any more space shuttles taking off. So that was incredible.
Awesome.
There was a night when I was in Papua New Guinea and I was on a ship because there's no good roads in Papua New Guinea really, because the terrain, the environment's too unpredictable. They have lots of mudslides and earthquakes and things like this. And so I was taking a ship around the coast, and I was on my left. I had this island called Manamum Island, I think, and it was an active volcano. It was glowing at the top, which is just incredible. And then to my right was the mouth of the Sepik River, which is kind of like the Amazon of Papua New Guinea. And that was there was a big thunderstorm, a big lightning storm over there. And in the middle was just the brightest stars I've ever seen in my life, a southern hemisphere stars. I was quite close to the equator, so it's one of those nights where you can see pretty much all the stars in the sky throughout the night. And I just sat out on the wing of the bridge of the ship, just going, wow, Earth porn. That was pretty cool.
That's incredible.
But my number one has got to be going up to the top of the Great Pyramid. That has been a dream of mine since I was a wee
little
baby.
I'm going to do the same, man. I'm going to take a picture.
Be very careful. One of the guys that I was out drinking with when I was in Cairo a few years ago, he was a French guy called Eric, and he was actually taken into custody for breaking curfew a couple of months ago. And the other inmates, they beat him to death in the cell, and the police didn't stop it. So just be careful, you know, especially in countries that are going through political instability. Again, it's being sensible. It's not putting yourself into positions where, you know, if you have been caught doing something a bit wrong.
Yeah.
Be sensible about it. Think of a way out of it. Probably bribe your way out of it.
Yeah. Graham, I got a question for you. This is an interesting one. Do you suggest women also travel the entire world alone? And if so, what extra precautions should they take, if any?
I know a lot of female backpackers who have traveled through the Middle East and Africa alone and not run into any trouble. I think you've got to have the right attitude. I think you've got to tell someone where you are at all times, but Twitter and Facebook are great for that. It's really easy when you go to a new country to buy a SIM card, they're usually about $1. And with that, you can make local calls and get local data. So just letting people know where you are and using the Couchsurf network, I think, really helps because you don't have to stay with men, you can stay with women. And if you arrange it in advance, which you have to do anyway, there'll be someone in each town waiting for you to arrive. So if you don't show up, they'll raise the alarm pretty quickly. I think you've got to have the right attitude. I think you've got to know the dangers and also don't cause trouble for yourself. If you are in a Middle Eastern country, you know, make sure that you cover your arms or wear a head wear something to cover your hair. Just don't put yourself
a naive American or Canadian. Just travel. No, it's just the truth. Travel, be a part of the culture, fit in.
Yeah.
Don't do anything out of the ordinary. Be aware of dangerous situations and dangerous places.
I think it's irresponsible to go to another country without actually doing a bit of research about the place and finding out, there's in every copy of Lonely Planet, when you look at the dangers and annoyances section, it'll tell you things about not just sort of safety and which areas to avoid and things like that, which you have in America and Canada and the UK anyway. But it also tells you things about scams, because a lot of backpackers fall for scams. And you know, when they tell you about it, you just kind of like got your hand in your head. You just go, oh, are you kidding me? But yeah. I was in Bolivia, this is a few years ago, and I really like Bolivia, but when I first arrived in La Paz, the capital, I was bundled into the back of a taxi, just off the overnight bus, coming in. Oh, you got a TR, that's nice. And I had a guy come in on my left, a guy come in on my right, and I was like squished in the middle between these two guys, and I thought, well, there must be a shared taxi or something. And then a policeman got in the front, or a policeman, showed me some ID, which looked a bit dodgy anyway, and then said, oh, we need to check that there were no drug dealers on that bus that you just got off, so show us your passport and how much money you've got. And I was like, there's no way I'm showing you my passport. I lied and said that it was in the hotel safe. I didn't have it. I've only got a photocopy. I didn't have any money on me. I've only got my credit card, and that's in the hotel as well. And the two guys that were next to me were all like, you know, pulling out wads of money and giving them to the police officer. He was counting them and giving them back and checking their passports. So it all looked a bit legit, but I kept my foot down and said, no, this ain't going to happen to me. I'm not going to hand over anything unless you take me to a police station. And in the end, they dropped me off. They dropped me off in like some bloody, you know, road on the outskirts of La Paz. But I got out. And when I got into the hotel, the hostel in La Paz, which I was staying, which, you know, I was planning to stay at anyway, they told me that this was a typical scam in La Paz, that, you know, because La Paz taxi scam, and I had not fallen for it, so I felt quite good that I sort of thought, hang on, this isn't right. But I'd been off an overnight bus, I'd only had a couple of hours sleep, it was 6 o'clock in the morning, I wasn't quite with it, so it could have gone either way, but I think that's the most important thing.
Good, man. Okay, well, quick question, how many languages do you know just to get by, basic stuff?
I barely speak English. I know a little bit of Spanish and a little bit of French.
Just like basic hello, how are you stuff.
Yeah,
like
where's
that.
The bus station? What time does the bus leave? I'd like to improve on that. And if I've won this island.
Does the world know English? I mean, you got by, so speaking English. Anybody know English?
The only places that's quite hard to get around, probably Russia. It's a bit difficult. Not Moscow or St. Petersburg, but I went to Kaliningrad, which is a little exclave of Russia, just the north of Poland, and that was a bit difficult. And the other place was China, sort of 10 years ago when I first went. That was difficult. But because all of the signs for the buses and things like that, and the towns were all in Chinese characters. So you had to look at your guidebook and sort out, you know, what the characters meant, and that was quite difficult. But since they had the Olympics in Beijing in 2008, most of the signs there are now in Chinese, and then underneath they're actually in Roman characters, so it makes it a little bit easier to see that it's actually the bus to Beijing.
Okay, cool. Okay, now that you've traveled the entire world, where would you settle down to have children if you had to? I know you don't want to, but if you had to.
Mars.
Where?
Mars.
Mars.
Or the moon. The moon.
Interesting answer, my friend.
No, Liverpool. Liverpool. I think if I was going to settle down, it would be...
I knew it. It's because your network's there. Your family's there. Everything's there.
It's a great city as well. It's a really cool city. It's a lot of fun to go out. You can go out any night of the week. It's not expensive like London. It's not a sprawl like Melbourne.
What if Canada bombed Liverpool and Liverpool didn't exist? Then where would you go?
Vancouver.
No.
Liverpool didn't exist. I've never been to Vancouver, so I wouldn't be able to say.
Where would you have a family and kids? Which place is the best place to shack up?
I don't know. I'd probably go somewhere else in England, to be honest with you, because where we are. No, seriously, where we are, we're quite central for travelling, and I really like the idea. I'm on the doorstep of Wales, right? Yeah. I can drive for half an hour. I'm in a different country where they speak a different language and have a different culture, you know? I think I said earlier where men are men and sheep are scared. And, you know, I think that's great. I think that's amazing that you could go, I can get in the Channel Tunnel within a few hours. I can be in Paris, I can be in Brussels, and even further afield. I've got all these countries on my doorstep, whereas in America and in Australia, somewhat, you could drive in any direction for a day or more, and you're still in the same country. You can't escape that culture, that same language, that same cuisine. Yeah. And so I feel like Europe is more, for the traveler in me, it's great to have this on my doorstep and be able to just get a really cheap, easy jet.
Okay, Graham, quick question. This is me personally. No one asked this, but I must know. Where are the most beautiful women in the entire world?
Everyone asks me this.
I hope your girlfriend's not listening.
Probably. I think maybe Colombia.
Yeah! Baby, you so sexy. I knew it! Knew it!
Madagascar.
Really?
Uzbekistan. Some hotties in Uzbekistan. Madagascar's great because Madagascar, you've got this very interesting cultural mix. You've got people who have ancestry from Africa, from India, from the Middle East, and from Europe, and they're all together and very unique looking people. Definitely.
Okay, now out of respect for women, where are the best looking men in the world? No homo.
Liverpool, baby.
No, you would say that.
Well, you know, if you like your men to be, you know, smart and passionate and interesting and have your hair.
Okay, we'll give it to you. Graham, here's a serious question of mine.
Okay.
What would the world look like if instead of going to university, every 19-year-old was required to do your 4-year, 201-country journey?
I think no one would know how to build a bridge. there were some practical applications to university, but nowadays it's about £9,000 a year now to go to university in the UK. And people used to ask me 10 years ago, should I go for traveling or should I go to university? And I'd always say, go to university, take a gap year, go traveling then. But now it's become so expensive to go to university, I'm erring on the side of just go traveling, because you're going to get like an experience out of that that you're not going to get.
Graham, what would it look like?
It'll cost you less.
Every person was required to see all 201 countries. Every person. What would anything change or no?
Yeah, I think it would be a lot more understanding of other people's cultures. I think that it would be a lot easier to travel around because people wouldn't be so terrified of these foreigners coming and stealing our jobs. I love that line by Louis C.K. where he said, if someone who can't speak the language and has no connections and has nowhere to live can steal your job, you're crap at your job.
They took our jobs! They took our jobs! They took our
jobs! I think the world would be a lot more sort of tolerant place, and I think we'd be a lot less scared as well. Because a lot of the news media feeds off that fear factor of, you know.
Well, Graham, you had a quote that people shouldn't judge other people by the decisions of their government. They should judge absolutely. Them by their own merit.
Yeah.
Graham, you're an inspiration to our generation. If no one's told you this, I will. You're Mr. Worldwide, and you know, you're putting it. I don't know. You're making traveling the world easy to do. And here's another question.
If you
had to remap everything you could do, like, you know, remap the entire world, how long, if you create a tour, a global tour, I could see 201 countries through the Graham Hughes tour. How much would it cost and how long would it take now that you've already done it and it could be more efficient the second time around?
It would cost more because it was going to be a commercial venture. You'd be charged for taking the cargo ships, which I got for free. So you look at it probably twice as much as I spent, but you could definitely do it if it was all organized. You could do it in between 12 to 18 months.
12 months? Yeah.
You got 60 months to go.
Buddy, you're making me look like a little pansy. I said I was gonna do 195 countries before 30, which is 60 months. And everyone says, oh, you're too ambitious, you're crazy. You did it in 48, and now you can say you can do it in 12.
I'm probably going to bring out a book this year, which is going to be just literally how to go to every country in the world. And that's going to be the whole point of the book. It's not going to be about my travels in particular. It's just, this is how you do Africa, this is how you do Asia, this is how you do South America.
Well, I'll tell you, Graham, I'll be the first one to buy that.
When's it out?
Book placement. I feel like Jay Leno right now. When's your book placement? What's it called?
Who's the publisher? Just, yeah. Keep an eye. I don't know who will publish it yet. Just keep an eye on Twitter. Because I'm mostly writing the book on my travels at the moment. And I want to do this as a sort of a follow-up, but it might come out on the same day, depending on if my agent thinks that's a good idea or not. But I do like the idea of having a handbook just to tell you how to do that, because I think there's more people than me want to do it. We want to go to every country, and it's that idea of ticking off that list, and I think it appeals to the generation that grew up with Pokemon and things. It's just, you've got to catch them all, you know. So.
Got to catch them all, buddy. Catch them all. Okay, well, Graham, I tell you, I'm only going to do 195 countries because that was my goal. I'm sticking with it.
Yep.
I am going to try to not die, and I will hopefully live on the dream. I will take planes. I'm not going to lie. Planes are efficient. They get you from point A to point B in incredible speed.
If you fly, you can do it in less than a year easily.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you, Graham, I hope to never have children, but if I do, I have a feeling it's going to be unintentional. But if I do have a child, I'm going to go get a university loan, and I'm going to take that money and tell them to go travel the world, see 201 countries, come back, and then tell me what they want to do with their life. And I think they'll come back a different man.
I think
that's a very good idea. I think a lot of the stuff that I learned when I was traveling, I mean, I felt in the first 2 years of travel, I learned more than all of my years of schooling put together. I studied history and politics, so that's right up my street. And the my view of the world now is a lot more, I don't know, what can I say? I've got a more positive view of the world now than I ever had before.
Amen.
It's my birthday. Oh, I've got a cake.
Okay, Graham. Well, thank you so much, sir. I really appreciate your time. Like I said, you're an inspiration to me. You're an inspiration to everybody around me. And thank you, sir. Hold on.
Okay, good seeing you.
We got some sound effects for you. Wait for it.
Okay.
Yay! Cheers, sir. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it. Everybody, if you want to go and follow Graham, his Twitter account is Every Country. Is that right?
Yeah, at Every Country.
Every Country. Okay, Graham, thank you so much, sir.
Take it easy, Graham.
Boom. All right, see you later. Bye-bye.